I didn't even raise my hand. Since you're already asking me to do it. I would pose this question to Eben, but others may also answer. And I completely agree with you all that a revolution has been made and delivered in terms of software, free software, and that's a huge change. So this is not one versus the other, but still, to what extent the fact that it has been mainstreamed and a lot of businesses, big businesses have taken it up, has to do with the fact that the value has shifted from the software layer to the application layer. And therefore, this has become a raw material to kind of take the dominances through the application layer. And I would be a little more specific even. Using Evan's word, he said FOSS was, software was mathematics and science. And then he gave more materiality to it by saying it is renewable resources rather than the stock non-renewable resources. What is the chance that data would start to be thought of either science or mathematics or a renewable resource, because I think that's where the next frontier lies. I know it's a whole different lecture, but if any pointers can be given to this, I would be grateful.
So I was trained as an historian, and my work, therefore, intellectually was based on a series of judgments about the nature of human activity, how human societies produce, which we've been building since the 17th century through various stages, from Adam Smith to Karl Marx to Sigmund Freud, all on the basis of what introspection could tell us about what human beings think and how they act. We're about to have an enormous revolution in the social sciences based around what we call big data now, which really just means that when you capture all the behavior of human beings, the difference between the conscious and the unconscious, the scientifically oriented and the politically oriented motives of human conduct fade away, and you are left with the inferences you draw from the vast bulk of what human beings do, what Sandy Pentland of MIT calls social physics. So it is true, as a statement about industry, that the application layer, which is really the user data layer, is of the greatest value now. We were in Bombay last week listening to various customers and commentators like ourselves at the Tata Consultancy Services talk about FOSS. And a gentleman who is a primary engineer at Flipkart spoke. And he spoke at great length about the FOSS that is used by Flipkart. And then at the end of the presentation, he said, well, you know, really, the only IP of our business is our user data, which is your point, put neatly. We spent some time this morning, Michelle and I, talking to the architects and designers of an unknown of Kenny's extent about what is, after all, essentially the same question: how is learning behavior to be captured in the world, and how is that to be used to benefit learning without harming the individuality of students? You're right, I think, that the data we collect is now a very important part, and will be ultimately a predominant part, of the science that I'm talking about, which is why I ended my remarks where I did, because I think the ability to use those skills is the most important accelerator of business development in the 21st century, and it might as well be here. On the other side, I don't think this is why FOSS has succeeded. That is to say, I think free software succeeded long before people really understood where that was going. FOSS succeeded, actually, in my personal judgment, if we are talking about all the GNU project that Mr. Stallman inspired and the Linux kernel that Linus Torvalds inspired. FOSS succeeded for a pure business reason. Fragmenting Unix was a really bad idea. AT&T didn't invent Unix in order to fragment. It invented Unix in order to take heterogeneous hardware and make homogeneous programming environments around it. Non-copyleft licensing, even free software licensing, created too many Unixes. AIX, HPUX, Sonos, then Solaris, Sosco Unix. There was a great over-differentiation in one corner of the world of software, and it warred on the technical benefits of the software as it was designed. far succeeded, in other words, with respect to the stuff that is the most commercially valuable in the world, because it made simpler technology, not more complicated technology. If you look at the relationship between Oracle and MySQL, you can see the same thing again. Now, it's really important, at any rate, I will concede the point, arguendo, as the lawyer said, it's really important to have great big heavyweight Oracle data warehouses if you're a bank or an airline or a telecommunications company, but you'd be out of your mind to expose that data warehouse to everybody browsing for an airline ticket or everybody making a checking account transaction through the web. MySQL functioned as a way of simplifying the enormous problems of vast data warehousing by affording cheap, reproducible, scalable satellite systems that could be used to interact with human beings for hours at a time, right up until the moment when, for 11 milliseconds, you actually bought the airline ticket and something had to be done in the main database. FOSS has simplified business, big and small. It's going to do it again as hardware changes how heavy computing works. Software is about to become much simpler, and FOSS is going to help make that simplification possible. Why do I say that? To a first approximation, all computer operating systems at present do one job. They move data back and forth from fast memory to slow memory and slow memory to fast memory. While they are busy pushing data around between types of memory with different physical characteristics, occasionally for one clock tick, a program actually does something. And then everybody goes back to moving data around from fast to slow to fast again, often through six or seven layers of caching and all the rest of it. We're about to live in a world in which there is a much different form of memory technology, whether it is what Intel and Micron were announcing last week, or what Hewlett-Packard has been working on with us for a while now, or what IBM or Oracle skunkwork projects ultimately produce. We're going to have a lot of very dense, very fast, non-volatile memory, which is essentially flat. Hewlett-Packard's The Machine, on which everybody's working right now, is an architecture meant for 128 petabytes of flat, monolithic, all-fast, all-the-same, non-volatile memory. As Martin Fink, Hewlett-Packard likes to say, denser than disks and faster than RAM. Although faster than RAM is a claim I don't think he's prepared to show yet. What that means is that software is going to stop doing most of the things software does, and it's going to start doing things in different ways. When you have relational database software, you have it because managing memory is really important, not because everything is best considered as a table. There are a lot of problems which will be solved differently in 10 years in fundamental senses because computer technology, hardware technology, got out of the way and software simplified. Now let's just imagine for a moment that we are actually going to have some new kinds of operating systems and some new kinds of software. Does anybody in the room believe that fundamental innovation like that is going to be done siloed, as Keith would say? Hewlett-Packard is currently working on The Machine, and it originally proposed, and Martin and I originally went to work on licensing, a new clean sheet operating system for The Machine, a very different kind of thing, on which, as you may notice if you've been reading the tech press in the last 60 days, Hewlett-Packard has given up. And not forever, just for now, because bringing the machine to market actually means what Martin calls Linux plus plus, and I call Linux minus minus. It's Linux, but without any read-writes, no piece of memory except for read and put back again. You restructure the kernel pretty seriously when you do that. And Keith Packard and other people who have long histories with the kernel are busy sitting at HP doing it. But the fundamental consequence is what you get done with is a thing that works like Linux, except it doesn't. And it simplifies and it makes different in every way. Well, that will be put out under GPLv2. It's a Linux kernel. Everybody will be able to share it. Hewlett-Packard will be busy working on silicon photonics and changes in fundamental memory design. But we will all have the Linux minus minus or the Linux plus plus kernel, and we will all be getting used to building operating systems and classes of hardware. And somewhere out there, there's a 16-year-old who is going to make the most important fundamental innovation that we're all going to have as a consequence of that activity. An impossible thing to imagine unless all the software is free to read, to study, to modify, to fix, to share, and to improve. So what's happening now, from my point of view, Parminder, is that the political economy of software and hardware industries is changing again. And what's about to happen with FOSS is the same thing that happened last time. People are about to discover the business efficiencies of simplification, and simplification is what we do. Now let's imagine the same thing about Indian government and the reason for the FOSS acquisition policy. You can imagine that what's going to happen is every state government's data center around India is going to be turned into a cloud all its own. Somebody's going to do it with VMware, somebody's going to do it with AWS, somebody or many somebodies are going to do it with OpenStack. That would be imagining a disaster. Or we could imagine that we simplify the matter drastically and all e-government activities of all Indian state and federal government agencies are conducted in one great big homogeneous Indian cloud. Utility computing everywhere for everybody, which will in fact leave a lot of room left over for citizen computing to occur. Just as AWS leaves a lot of room open for computing to occur when Amazon is not in the middle of its Christmas sale. When you move towards architectures of omnipresent utility computing with large amounts of memory flatly available to everybody, you can begin to describe a national computing environment for a billion people, which isn't Facebook with a billion users. It's a national cloud with a billion people in it, taking and putting and making and using and in ways that we can't even begin to model until we start accomplishing it. I think that's fun. I think it's not about we went up the value chain until we got to operating system software, and then we did a little bit of computer programming languages, and then we did web, and now we're in the era of data. I think the point is capitalism has done a terrific job complicating computing because everybody wanted to differentiate everywhere they could and build their products everywhere that they could get an edge. And the sharers have been busy simplifying everything all along. GCC is the greatest work of simplification of compiler technology anybody ever saw. As the Apache web server was a big step forward on CERN HTTPD, which was the first web server I ever ran. Everything got simpler. It keeps getting simpler. Because one of the primary itches that young hackers have is to do it in a simpler way so they can move on to doing something else they need to do. So I'm with you for the data you're bringing to the thing, but I think the evidence proves something a little bit different than you're letting on.
The currency of as software is getting more complex, the benchmarks and currency of evaluating the value or innovation quotient of software universally amongst whether it's the VC community or governments for R&D grants still lies on patents. Is there any way that you guys are working to change the thought process of that community to something other than patents?
Yeah, I mean, I mentioned defensive publications. I think if you look at IBM, and many people, you look at the MIT Innovation Review, which is every first quarter of every year, which looks at who's patented and who the leaders are, and every year IBM is at the top of the list. When people look at that, that grossly underestimates the inventive power and output that they actually manifest in a given year, because it doesn't take into account the thousands of defensive publications that they produce. And so I think that's indicative of the problem that we see in many municipalities around the world, where people struggling to find something to actually evaluate the productive output of an entity, whether it be a startup or a micro industry, a macro industry. They're trying to evaluate, what are we really producing? Are we having a net effect? Patents are being used inappropriately, and as part of the corruption of the patent system, that we're getting people to file as many patents as possible in order to ensure that they're able to access the next tranche of money to be able to support their invention. I think VCs that are clever recognize that that's a complete fallacy, and they recognized it a long time ago. And I think if any VC that thinks that either the innovative capacities or the potential success factors associated with a startup are tied to its patents, there are very, very, very few cases where the patents are the differentiator, where they're the source of onward differentiation to be able to sustain a business. It's how smart the people are, how quickly they iterate, and how quickly they're able to adapt to complex situations. And so patents are important, but we see a trend in the U.S. anyway, where there's a movement away from creating patents with innovation by sophisticated individuals. And the community clearly recognizes that most people in the community, the core developer, hacker cadre, are anti-patent. They don't. The problem that I have with that is that they don't codify what they produce and prevent others from getting patents in that jurisdiction or another jurisdiction that come back to haunt all of us in the community years, months, or years later. And so what we're trying to do is encourage the codification of inventiveness so that we can show over the last 23 years of Linus's Linux that there's been an incredible amount of inventive output. And that inventive output is something that that patent trolls now have resources that they're utilizing to be able to create a lost generation the only people making money in this whole process are lawyers. But all we're doing is clogging up the courts. We're slowing and we're stalling the uptake of technology by creating fear, uncertainty, and doubt in the system. And it's a lot of noise. That noise is created by the fact that we didn't codify everything that was produced in the last 23 years of Linus's Linux to be able to allow that to serve as a statement of prior art, preventing other people from filing patents. And so we're not helping the quality challenge. That's really what it is we have to raise the bar collectively. I was just in Beijing last week. They get it. They've instituted a government program designed to produce defensive publications to capture all of the inventiveness across their various industries to be able to ensure that the quality of what ultimately gets patented is that much higher. We can debate whether software should be patentable, what is patentable subject matter in general, but in the meantime, if we are proactive and we file everything that we have in defensive publications, make it accessible to the patent and trademark offices here and everywhere around the world, we'll have far fewer patents. And then we can continue to legislate and to direct the courts to be able to deal with these issues based on their jurisdictional issues and our preferences and predilections. But really what we need to do is be activists in making sure that people can't file on patents that are representative of the creativity of the community. And I think people are starting to get that. I mean, clearly the Chinese get that. The U.S., we have a massive repository called IP.com, which is on every desktop of every patent examiner in Washington.
Ben, a lot of VCs, at least as Keith said, who are smart enough to understand the strategies, they also know whether if whatever your product is, your technology is good enough, they also understand how constrained you are for money. What exactly is the smart strategy you have done to manage your IP? But sometimes maybe that, okay, I have a defensive patent strategy, maybe not patents, because I did not spend $30,000 getting a patent application prosecuted in the US, but instead, because otherwise I would not have money to enforce that to prevent someone else, but instead I did the defensive patent strategy, or I have a smart way to monetize my own, or trademarks and copyrights, which is not always going to be an enforcement action. In India, there are no software patents allowed by Section 3K of the Indian Patents Act. But that doesn't mean there is nothing which is actually going through the holes there, and nothing is being granted out here. One of the empirical studies which our organization here did, until we have data until about 2013, but we are, I think by next month we will have real-time data about if anything which looks like software is being granted from the patent office. And what patent office here wants to show as innovation seems to be more 98%, or it's actually 98.3% of the data of the patents which are being granted are all to multinational corporations. None of them are Indians. So that doesn't mean whatever they want to call innovation is happening. Then there is the government of India, apart from these other policies, also rethinking its intellectual property rights policy. Because they understand, whether it's the pharma sector or it's the technology sector, that's where either they are going to actually be run into some trouble or going to actually circumvent the system and get to what they want. We've seen how the Novartis case played out in the Indian Supreme Court and what is the requirement of the Indian market in terms of the drug prices and what in our patent policies in pharma did for the generic pharmaceutical industry for India in the 1970s, they understand that should be the same thing here. And that's any startup who is trying to make a strategy about patents, one has to have a different strategy in the US or in European Union from what it has in India. So we've been engaging with the Indian government, where they understand, because in the beginning, they put lawyers to make a policy about law. All they want is more law, because that's how their bread is buttered. So they wanted to say, yes, let's talk more about patents. And talking more than suddenly, or educating ourselves about intellectual property law, will make us more innovative. Not that I understand that argument, but I understand what the motivation of that argument is. In our discussions, and because our clients want us to go and talk, whether it's not the, not just the free software projects, but also the small and medium enterprises. We've spoken to Sharad about it, and various other people who I at least advise in India, wanted to say, we don't have the money. And as you said, the VC is asking for, what have you done about your IP? And we think that patent means innovation, what should we be doing? And that's what we had the conversation, whether it is at the highest level with the Commerce Minister, Mr. Sitaraman, or their think tank, to say, you're gonna have an innovation policy, not an intellectual property rights policy. That's not what the ecosystem, the Digital India, Make India buzzwords are about. You're serious about this, we can see it, because that's what your policies are. But you have to think a little more creatively to give them enough leeway for not wasting money on lawyers or trying to worry or stay up at night about, am I doing it the right way or am I going to run into a patent problem or not? Many of our clients don't know and sometimes ask this question in the US, do I have to do a freedom to operate search myself? Do I have to go and look for patents? Because I may be working on something which is already patentable without realizing that's something you don't want to do because that means intentional infringement. So it's also at the policy level one has to think, and because there are so many people who are actually innovating and working and have the ear of the policymakers, they need to hear it from you guys. We're talking to them, and all we heard was, yes, this makes a lot of sense, but we do not know how to articulate it in order to present it to the people on the other side who would actually want you to have that. But it's the Ericsson litigation, which I do not know how many of you are following. It's the standard essential patent litigation.
You could speak a little bit about that.
Ericsson, of course, is now out of making business, but they're now in the business of monetizing their patents. So there are four litigations and some also proceedings going on right now in the Competition Commission of India. And those four litigations are pending in Delhi High Court against Micromax, Intex, and then Xiaomi, also in India, not an Indian company. And one more, the name escapes me right now, but I can give you the details. And these are about, of course, the royalties and how the, even if the standard essential patents had to be licensed on franc terms, what is it, how are you going to calculate it? There's not much of precedence out here in India on these issues. But then this very, very clearly ties to the question of what is it that we're going to allow here? What are patents actually allowed? What is it that they're enforcing? Patent negotiations are conducted in the secret, of course, but when the courts step in, and Delhi High Court rightly has this reputation of being pro-IP, because most of the lawyers in Delhi High Court who become judges or who practice there think, yeah, that's what we like. Shah Rukh Khan coming in saying, oh, piracy, PSA, or that's what copyright law is all about. Because somehow very pro-IP and coming down heavily on everything is suddenly going to make us the United States, and that's all. That seems like the right thing to do from their perspective. Or also, I'm not going to say that I'm not under pressure from the trade organizations or the USIDCs or the various other companies. But that litigation, why it is important and to watch out what's really going on. Last Friday, Ericsson, along with ASSOCHAM, invited the Director General of the Competition Commission of India to present to them a paper about why patents are good. That's, and then a lot of people wrote about it, Perminda knows about it, that objecting and to saying like, so how does the conflict of interest rules play out here? What you're going to do, this is exactly what pharma would do. They would gather a bunch of people and then say, this is why you need patents here. The only people who were going to object were Mezzo Sans Frontier or some local organizations who understood that higher price of patented drugs is not what India needs. And we do not need to have the same IP policy as the United States has or Japan has. We just need a different policy. And that does not make us a banana republic with no rule of law. US tries to put us on this 301 list, which is a complete sham all this time, to tell us, oh, we don't have enough strict enforcement of IP law. It's not like China. We have very strict enforcement action. Our copyright law is very strict, I would say.
And I guess, you know, when it comes to the software patent, at least the government in India has been fairly judicious in the sense that they have ensured that software is not patented in subject matter.
That's what the legislation says. So the parliament already legislated and decided that there's no patenting of software. And the patent office has done the right thing. But the shenanigans are going on anywhere. That's why we see all these patents coming out. And our way of doing this was that we cannot go and oppose each patent at one point in time. We're going to do it a different way. I will say there is this consulting company, and I don't mind naming them, Accenture, which has a patent filed in India, granted, which actually just is an expert sitting in a remote location, transferring knowledge to somebody who's a novice in another location. Now tell me which university which is using MOOC or a BPO or somebody else is not going to be covered by that patent application. I have spent five years...
I had a similar patent in which we fought and had, and so they gave it up. So it's outsourcing, as offshore outsourcing was patented by IBM, I think 2007, 2008, something like that. There was a big hue and cry about it, so, yeah, I mean...
There is a post-grant
application. So US PTO grants some really rubbish patents.
No, this is Indian PTO.
No, I'm saying, that's the US PTO, this is the Indian PTO, they're both the same.
Well, and in the Indian patent office, we've spent 4 years with this battery of lawyers on the other side, just trying to fight that patent. And that's everybody's water which we are carrying. It affects everyone, the universities, the big IT companies, or talk to anybody. And all they had to come and say, starting from, we're not gonna really use this patent.
I think the large companies' philosophy is more from a patent troll perspective and market capture, but from a startup perspective, you know, our experience in, for example, in Singapore is that they grant R&D taxation benefits if you do innovation and R&D. You try and explain to them, they don't get it. But you wave a patent, instantly they sign and say, okay, there you are. So from a startup, you know, the time taken to try and do all that stuff versus go bung in out and spend money which is not really useful to put a patent in, that's the issue.
Tax forming the patent code is also a popular mode in France and in some other places where similar forms. What you really are seeing is the public buying patents at very high prices of very low quality. And that's it's an information discrepancy problem. The tax system or the subsidy system for innovation regards all patents as equal. Anybody who actually looks at patents knows they're nothing of the kind.
Yeah.
And so you have a pricing failure, and that pricing failure should be corrected by other forms of intervention. Look, if you sum over what has been said, I think what people are saying in different respects is the pendulum has already begun to swing back. She was on the brief with me in the U.S. Supreme Court and Alice Corp. And what we got out of the United States Supreme Court was the third consecutive lopsided or unanimous ruling that abstract ideas aren't patentable. We always told you that. And what we really mean is patenting business methods won't go, patenting algorithms won't go. And the USPTO has begun rejecting pretty much all the stuff in that line. It's significant that the last cases in the United States Supreme Court have all been appeals by people who filed patent applications who didn't get them because the PTO thought they were abstract, and then the courts were sure, and the Supreme Court said, no, we mean what we say. Similarly, because of efforts by Michigan and other lawyers here, Sam was pointing to it, any effort by the Indian PTO to get around 3K when the examiner's manual seemed to suggest that software per se was a very narrow reading, everybody backed down, and everybody's characterization of the Indian PTO is now trying to implement the statute as it
is. Since we have another 15-20 minutes to go, I think I'd like to bring the focus back to entrepreneurship. I'd like to ask Mishi a very blunt question as to, you know, if I am a software entrepreneur or open source or free software project, how does SFSC help you?
If you're a free and open source software project, which means that you're going to make whatever technology you work on freely available for everyone to consume, then we provide free legal services to any such project. If you are a startup who is going to monetize it, then you are a company and I'm a lawyer. I send you a bill or I send you a company. And the only difference I would say is that we don't try to clock hours to just run to milk you. What, as I earlier was saying, it's mostly, I see it as a counsel's job rather than as a lawyer's job. I want to tell you what is going to be good for you as a strategy matter more than, this is the law, I'll register a mark, I'll do, and I will write some policy and there you go. I really want to understand your business. I want to understand and maybe tell you, maybe I don't understand the technology, but I have had another client who was trying to do something similar, and I saw them make some mistake or do something really well. And just to tell you, okay, sometimes imitation works in terms of strategy. There are attorney client privilege rules, which I follow very, very strictly, even if here they mean something very different. But so I cannot really tell you what someone else is doing in the same way I will not tell them what I'm doing with you. But of course I know and I've learned and I've gained knowledge, and that's what we can bring to you. So it's usually flat, and we have an Indian office. Many times I hand out my American card, and what I hear is, oh, we'd really like to hire you, but we cannot afford the New York prices you're going to quote, but we do have an Indian office, and that sends bills in rupees and not in US dollars, and not just converted, but actual rupees at market price here. So if you're a free software project, we are free at your service. But if you're not a free software project, then also it's a pretty good idea to hire us.
Let's describe what actually gets done for people. We make non-profit and for-profit corporations around the world. We have recently just finished helping the client, which is a free software project with an extremely complicated international banking problem involving setting up some entities in two different countries. We occupy ourselves with the creation of what we call condominiums, which are homes for projects that can centralize administrative and financial activities for dozens of projects at a time. We help people choose their licenses. Is this an MIT X11 kind of a thing? Is this a copyleft kind of a thing? What kind of mixture of AGPL and LGPL might you want? When people have licenses, we help them make sure that those licenses are respected. We haven't brought any wide-scale litigation around the world since 2010 because I don't actually think litigation is a very good idea. It costs a lot of money and it only makes one point at a time. But having done a pretty solid job of waking everybody up, then actually, of course, it's phone calls. We do patent defense. You know, some company decides that some free software project should not be allowed to do what it is doing because they have a patent. One possibility is we work with OIM to say, yeah, well, you're about to get yourself into all kinds of other trouble. Another possibility is we actually sit with clients and we make claim charts and they say, no, we're not infringing, we're pretty solid. You really want to try this? And the first time that Mishi swung a baseball bat at the nose of a shark like that, I think she thought it was not going to work out well. But the truth is, if you know what you're doing and you swing the right baseball bat at the nose of the shark at the right moment, away it goes. We work very closely with OIM, as we have said before, to make our projects OIM licensees. Another very important project, OpenSSL, became an OIM licensee a week ago on our strong urging as it begins to understand the more complicated environment of OpenSSL in the near future. In other words, what we are, as I said before, is lawyers for invisible software companies. We do headquarters functions. The Debian project with all 33,000 of its packages in it has a very complicated trademark policy. It's not like Playboy Enterprises, which says we have a trademark, we're going to hurt you. What Michi actually did, and she is the author of their trademark policy and the enforcer of their policy around the world, what we actually had to do was say, we really want you to be able to use the name Debian. There are a few things you need to do in order to do that, and then we really want you to be able to use the swirl sometimes, and sometimes not. And there are things we really need you to think about that have to do with what you're doing with this software before we license you for nothing, the trademark. So our trademark licensing practice may be more complicated and sophisticated, even though it produces a lot less money and a lot less litigation than that of some of the LVMHs of the world who are very... They're insistent on their trademarks, but their method is very simple. It's just pay me. The beauty, as Michi said in her talk before, of what we do is that we do a lot of different things, and we try and do them all very well. I made SFLC in the United States to be a training practice, as I said, to train people to take care of geese that lay golden eggs. And one of the really important parts about the practice is that the lawyers who work with us, both here in India and in the United States, are true experts at doing everything that software companies need. We're just on a very small scale with very small billing. But we do all the stuff that our colleagues at Oracle and IBM and Hewlett-Packard and, for that matter, TCS or Infosys do.
Facebook. Made a,
do we really?
No, you talked about that, you know, it's a transient model and it'll get replaced with something else. And I know in your mind you have the next generation architecture which is much more distributed. Could you talk a little bit about that? That would be very...
Well, look, I mean, I said years ago that Facebook was free web hosting with a few PHP doodads and spying all the time. And nothing that has happened has changed my mind about that, right? The problem was, in my judgment, from a technical point of view, that we created stuff called browsers, and grimy as they worked really well. People could read the web no trouble. My Apache clients made beautiful web server software, but we didn't help people use it very well. So the process of getting to the web was really, really hard as a writer. As a reader, it was simple. That created a technological vacuum into which all kinds of badly designed software stepped. And Facebook is the worst design possible for the task of giving people web hosting because it puts one man in the middle and he keeps all the logs. I said in a public speech, actually one about Edward Snowden, that not showing young people growing up web logs is like not showing them what happens if you have car crashes without seatbelts. I went by a billboard on the way here in which the Bangalore police are showing in a fairly graphic way what happens if your two-wheeler crashes and you're not wearing a helmet. We didn't explain to people very well what that kind of captive web hosting does. And we didn't tell people that the anonymity of reading is important. So most of the students I deal with, even knowledgeable law students in the United States, they assume that the Facebook privacy problem is about what they post. It never really occurs to them that the Facebook privacy problem is about being surveilled in everything they read. That the data mining of web reading behavior is overwhelmingly dangerous to the web reader who doesn't understand what those logs are showing about them. So we created a man-in-the-middle attack on the web, and we ushered a whole lot of young people into that web with the MITM in it. And we just sort of said, isn't this cool? Now you can keep in touch with everybody you went to first grade with. And that was irresponsible. So what I said beginning in 2010 is, we can't forbid it, let's replace it. And what that really means is bringing the web back as a writable medium for people in an easy way. The wiki revolution is helpful in that sense for certain kinds of high content, high quality, high density, high intensity content. Richard Stallman wrote an article called The Universal Encyclopedia in 1979. Wikipedia did it. It works. The problem is that that's not really good for status updates and little smart-ass comments I would like everybody to read, and, you know, which is also perfectly good use of the web. But when you have platformized it, when you have turned it into a non-distributed, centralized system of I keep all the logs and I know what you think better than you do yourself, you have created a social danger that ought not to exist. What I see is next generation architecture could just as easily be described as Tim Berners-Lee last generation architecture. Federated services. Email is terrific in part because it's a federated service and because standing up a mail server is no big deal. Everybody forgot that. And so they decided to put all the world's email over here in one chain link fenced off place, which it was not surprising to discover that NSA and FSB and everybody wanted it. Everybody thought, oh no, we can't have end-to-end encryption of mail because we want to show people ads based on the content of their email, which amounts to, we wish to read all the world's email in order to do better advertising. This too is bad technology and shouldn't be permitted. Now, after Snowden, Google and Apple got that point enough that Tim Cook wants to go to the Electronic Privacy Information Center annual dinner and say Apple doesn't keep any data on its users. I had no idea what he was talking about. And Google now offers end-to-end mail encryption, and prosecutors around the world were on the front page of the New York Times yesterday saying, that shouldn't be allowed, that's no good. A marginal benefit of whole disk encryption is not as much as solving some crimes. But people are beginning to get the idea. You have to be able to trust the internet. Whatever the internet means to you, you have to be able to trust it. If you can't, you're living in KGB land all the time. Whether it's the government you're afraid of, a corporate surveillance you're afraid of, or the intervention of a 12-year-old in St. Petersburg who's going to steal your identity, we must have a thing we trust. And we have to explain to people what kinds of software they can trust and what they can't. Distributed social networking will happen. It's not that hard a problem. We are working here, as we are working in the United States, on a little project I care a lot about called Freedom Box, which is just cheap hardware doing router jobs using free software in ways that encourage privacy. By late this year, early next, we'll have the new social and diaspora in there. And by in there, I mean in villages in Karnataka and AP, where Freedom Box workers are now already distributing prototypes. And what we will be saying to people is, servers are not. They're just a different kind of computer. They fit in your pocket, you plug them in, you plug them in the wall, forget about them. And they do your mail, and your sharing, and your status updates, and all of those things, but they don't deliver the logs to a little thug in a hoodie in Menlo Park. And therefore, they also don't make the content monitoring system such a piece of cake. And therefore, they don't create a world in which it's so easy to get to the email of everybody in India with a Muslim last name. And a whole lot of other, what I guess we could call positive externalities flow from the world. What happened was we misshaped the web. We didn't even know we were doing it because most of the people didn't understand what the web was supposed to be. They didn't know it was a bunch of peers each doing its own thing. They thought it was some system given to them by a platform maker. We're going to un-misshape the web, at least I hope we are.
Every time one of us logs into Facebook, I think we'll have this image of the thug in a hoodie.
Well, every time you log into Facebook, you should remember that the entire web is now surveilled. It's not your activity on Facebook only. Once you're logged in, it's every page in the web you read with a like button on it, which is every page in the web you read. So what's going to Menlo Park isn't just the log of your activity on Facebook. What's going to Menlo Park is your log of all your activity on the web everywhere. I don't think you meant to do that.
I'm
quite sure.
When you think about big data, it's quite amazing. For example, the person at Flipkart who was speaking last week, he mentioned that according to their analytics, they found that the peak time that people buy diapers is after midnight. And who would have thought about that? And to know that a computerized system is understanding you to a level where it's much better than you yourself.
I went to Evan's class in 2005, and he was talking about predicting a woman was pregnant just by watching what she was buying in a grocery store.
And in 2005,
you had that target situation, right? Where they sent.
And in 2005, remember, there was no Fitbit.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? We are monitoring the body now for other people's benefit. Your phone can see your heart rate because it can see tiny changes in your complexion as you hold it up to your face. That Fitbit. We had an earthquake north of San Francisco last year in Mendocino, and the Jawbone guys with their fitness bracelets, they produced a lot of data about who woke up when and how long it took them to go back to sleep. And there was a kind of seismic map of the society based on your bed shook, you woke up, you and your wife had a little conversation, you went back to sleep, or maybe you couldn't sleep because you were afraid it was going to shake again. That hooking up all those human bodies to monitored structures, that's pretty deep and pretty serious and not a good idea. And everybody thinks it's a terrific idea because I have a fitness monitor. If it were a distributed service, I would say it was great. As a centralized service, I think it's the matrix.
So I hate to ask very practical questions, but I think one of the questions that I do need to ask is, How does Open Invention Network help Indian startups? What is the tangible the benefit to an Indian startup?
Well,
sorry to interrupt you, but yeah, you know, in India we do not have software patents, so how does an Indian startup benefit from being a member?
Well, if you want to be legal advised with no bill, take an OIN license.
Through the use of a license, we've driven a culture, and that's really, we utilize a license as a vehicle. But really what we're looking to do is essentially simulate what the GPL does in terms of providing rules for compliance and how we comport ourselves and how we essentially identify what we're building on when we create a product. That's what you do, that's what the GPL in loose form is helping you do, so that you understand and can manage and make sense out of a world that might, appear very complex at first in terms of how I participate in open source and stay in a positive direction and stay in compliance. On the patent side, we didn't have that. And so 10 years ago, these companies got together and they said, we need to implement something like this that allows for freedom of action in the areas where we collaborate, where we're interdependent, where we truly are reliant on each other to be able to create new novelty to innovate. And so in what's core in all of the major projects in the world, minor projects in the world, we look at the fundamental technology, the fundamental packages of which we've identified 2,300 packages that are in all manner of distributions, OSs, and open source projects on which we rely and use on a regular basis, whether we know it or not, and basically have said, this is going to be the core. This is going to be the area where we're going to implicitly, tacitly agree that we're not going to sue each other because we're relying on each other, we're interdependent here. It's like the idea of co-opetition. We cooperate and compete. Where we cooperate, we don't sue each other. Where we compete, normal rules apply, and as I said before, you can kind of pursue whatever strategy you want, whatever makes sense for you, driven by your need to get government funds based on having 12 patents last quarter or whatever it happens to be. But what we've done is actually get buy-in from thousands of 1,700 companies now, and that by the time I come back here in February, we'll probably have 2,500 companies that are participating in this community. And it's not based on whether they're U.S. companies, whether they have patents, don't have patents. In fact, most of the companies in our community don't have any patents. What we do is say, if you're going to agree to this basic rule that you're not going to sue based on what's in the core of Linux and open source more broadly, that we're going to give you access to $90+ million worth of patents that we buy, many of which you're probably infringing, because we have a fundamental e-commerce portfolio. I don't go to Flipkart and say, hey, you're probably violating this patent and the claims of this patent, but the reality is we just give them away. We don't have any kind of licensing program that generates revenue. Everything is free. There's no analog in the history of technology to what OIN is. We needed something that was different, that was heretical, to be able to work within this environment, to be able to ensure inclusion and ensure that we'd have this whole notion of cooperation. And so essentially, we require that if you have patents that read on what's core to Linux and is open source kind of system that you agree that you're going to cross-license everyone else in the community. So we have a cross-license of thousands of patents, but the number of the owned patents by the numbers of companies that are in our cross-license pool is well over a million patents. So some percentage of those that relate to the core of Linux and open source are cross-licensed. You get access to that, plus you get access to the over 1,000 patents that we have, $90 million in value.
The question is, so why is it that it's licensed on free of cost?
It's done free of cost because it's the only way to maintain a pro-competitive platform where everybody gains access. It's open to everyone. There is no benefit that's unique to IBM or Red Hat or Sony or Google or any of the people who fund this. They're doing it and they're guiding my hand, but essentially I have a raised capital fund with more money behind it, a call option on additional funds to be able to accomplish the goal of creating patent freedom.
If you charge for non-aggression, you're aggressive. The real way to think about this, let's do the math on it. So you're a startup, maybe you have a few patents, maybe you don't. Whatever you have is not enough to defend you against big people who have lots, but you have an OIN license for free. Now you have an agreement of non-aggression with many, maybe most, of all the big players in your world. Your patents are available to them. That's not much cost to you, and it doesn't change your venture capitalist view that you should have some patents because no VC ever thinks you should have patents and no licenses. So you've cross-licensed advantageously. That's a good story for the financiers. And you have eliminated whole issues, whole classes of issues of risk that are going to be relevant when you decide you want to go IPO and everybody's starting to ask, well, what might your soft underbelly be? So you've closed all that up. One of the reasons I like representing FSF is that Richard Stallman runs UMass Zero, as you know, so I can talk about things a little bit. There's an all-free version of Android called Replicant, which basically exists by taking unfree software out of Android and leaving itself with a lump of stuff we can use. Replicant was hosting itself at Gutorius, and there is no more Gutorius, and so it needs a home. FSF would like to provide a home to Replicant, and make Replicant a GNU project and bring it into FSF's hosting and management system. And of course, a reasonable question is, what kind of patent problem might we be exposing ourselves to if we go and host a free version of Android? So Michi and I did some work, and I'm not going to say everything we said, but I'll tell you what the first thing we said was, well, actually, you have very small problems because FSF is an OIN license. FSF doesn't advertise that it's an OIN licensee because its official position is software patents are bad and you shouldn't do it and all that, but our clients are rational organizations and FSF is an OIN licensee. It's a free rider licensee. It will never have any patents because it hates patents, but it's not an impermissible free rider, and that means we can give Replicant a home. Because we know that with an OIN license and with all the issues that all the OIN board and member companies have over keeping Android safe, nobody's going to make a fuss with FSF. That would really be dumb. It would start an enormous war in which all the OIN parties would be on our side over the no royalties we can pay from the no income we have. That's safety. OIN is safety in that way for both small, young commercial properties and also for nonprofit, non-revenue problem entities because it offers non-aggression at a price everybody can afford. This, as Keith says, has no analog anywhere else. There's no paint companies, no oil companies, no trucking companies. There's nobody in the world who has ever succeeded in building that kind of safety. And the really important part of this, both plus and minus, is that Keith built that in the middle of a war. It was easier in some sense and harder in others, but he built that in the middle of the biggest patent war in history. That's really quite an achievement.
Thank you, Evan. I think we are running short of time. So, do we have tea or coffee? Sir?
Yeah, we have.
So maybe we can take the discussions over that.
I have a small question. Can an individual be part of that, or is it an organization only?
Can an individual? Yeah,
license.
Yeah, we have
hundreds
of individuals.
So. A connected question is, I'm an individual, I signed that, but I'm working for an organization. How does it relate? And if I have two people co-authoring a patent, what are the implications?
Let's have coffee.
Yeah.
It's better to give advice.
An individual can't find, you can't find your parents, but you know your the company you work for, but you can be, you can have a protection yourself. So in all the activities you involved in as an individual, if you want the company to have it, then they should sign a license as well.